Good morning, Burleson Church. How is everybody doing today? It's lovely to be here worshiping with you. We've had a wonderful Thanksgiving week, and here we are on the Sabbath after Thanksgiving, celebrating still all that God has done for us and is doing for us, and all the thankfulness that we have in our hearts for who He is. Would you join me as we bow our heads for prayer and begin our worship service together? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for being the God that you are, our great, big, awesome, good God, and we are here today to worship you. We pray that the Holy Spirit would pour out in a mighty way, that you would fill this place, and that as we hear the testimonies and the stories of how you have led and how you have guided, may we be encouraged, may we be emboldened, may we be renewed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
For today, for this gift of breath and life, we give you thanks. For this church, this community gathered here to worship, we give you thanks. For your creation, the changing seasons, falling leaves, we give you thanks. For your mercy, for your forgiveness, for your love, we give you thanks. In our weakness, we thank you, for your power is made evident. In our failures, we thank you, for your grace is sufficient. Even in the trials, through the struggles and pain, as you form us into who you want us to be, turning our mess into your message. Today and every day, we give you thanks.
Welcome, church family. Happy Sabbath. We hope you definitely enjoyed your Thanksgiving holiday. I had a lot to eat. I know I did. Thank you to my beautiful wife. I had a lot of food. Amen. Okay, we have a few announcements for you this morning. Our annual tradition, the angel tree, is up. I hope you guys have seen it just in the foyer area. As you're exiting here, it's going to be to your left. We invite you to take a small gift bag from the angel tree and replace it with an ornament that you'll see to on the side of it. Replace it with an ornament from the basket that's there. If you could purchase what is on the card in the gift bag and place it under the tree, we ask that it be unwrapped. As amazing as some of you wrap your gifts, the company we are partnering with, they ask that it be unwrapped. So if you can bring the gifts unwrapped, and if you can bring them before December 10th, please, okay? Thank you so much for helping us bless our community in this way. The church Christmas program will be on December 10th as well. The church choir will provide several numbers and lead the congregation a beloved Christmas carols, right, that we can all sing along. That'll be an amazing time, a fun Sabbath. And of course, what is a Christmas program without some children involved as well, helping us tell the greatest story ever told? We also have the church social.
Hi, Danny.
Oh, hello, Leilani. How are you?
I'm socializing right now.
You are socializing. Everyone, please welcome Leilani.
Hello.
Okay. Do you need the, you need
I think he was telling us about the church social. Look at us socializing and being friends. Yes. Don't you want to celebrate with your family Christmas?
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. Thank you.
When is that?
It is on December 10th as well. It is a packed Sabbath. It's going to be fun, though, at 6:30 p.m.
We're going to be celebrating so much, you guys. I think you want to come.
Yes, it's going to be a great time. Thank you so much, Leilani, for socializing with me and for socializing with all of us this morning. So yes, December 10th, don't miss out at 6:30 p.m. in our fellowship hall, okay? It's going to be a very, very fun time. We're going to be watching Christmas movies and eating some amazing Christmas goodies, right? We'll have more information coming soon. We have Pastor Dale. He would like to give us some information about our prayer conference call.
I want to thank all of you who come and join us for our prayer time on Tuesday evenings at 8 o'clock. But what I want to highlight to you is we're not using the old numbers anymore. Your bulletin has the new number. And so what you simply do, we wanted a local number. Some were getting long distance charges. So we have a local number you can call. You enter then your access code. Those are all printed in your bulletin. Just keep those because we want to hear from you again this coming week. And thank you for being a praying church.
Thank you, Pastor Dell. And for our last announcement, we do not have breakfast next Sabbath, right? As we typically do every first of the month. However, we are moving our breakfast to Christmas Eve Sabbath, okay? So don't miss out. We invite you to be here. We're going to have some delicious food. It'll be from 9:15 to 10 a.m., okay? We hope you'll join us for some holiday breakfast time with your entire family. Thank you so much. We hope you have a wonderful Sabbath. We invite the kids. If the kids could come up, right now is the time for the children's story. And don't forget, there should be some dollars, some offerings being waved around. And in this season of thankfulness, don't forget, kids, to say thank you as you're picking up those dollars, as you're walking around.
All right, check this out. Ooh. Is that annoying? To some people it is. You know what else is annoying? Complaining. Just imagine when we complain and our words are lifted up and God hears them, it's annoying, isn't it? Because God gives us all good things and takes care of all of our needs. And when we complain, oh, the Bible tells us stories about people who complained, like the Israelites. God miraculously brought them out of slavery and set them free. And next thing you know, they're complaining. My feet hurt. I'm hungry. I'm thirsty. Where are we going? Are we there yet? And God heard those complaints, and the trouble was those complaints came from their heart. Oh, that was sad. But do you know, boys and girls, what we need to do? We need to let go of our complaints and give praise and thanksgiving instead. When you're tempted to complain, just stop and think, how can I thank God instead? We talked about some of those things last week, didn't we? So that when we make that habit of being thankful and praising and worshiping God, pretty soon, instead of complaints coming from our heart, worship and praise and thankfulness come from our hearts. And it changes how we see life, and it changes how we experience life, and we find we are so much happier when we praise and when we're thankful. So I want you to remember this week, when you're tempted to complain, change that complaining into praise and thankfulness. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Do you want a balloon? All right, let's pray first. Who would like to have our prayer? All right.
Jesus, let everybody have a good day. Let everybody have a good day, and let everybody be happy. Amen.
Amen. After you do your praise song, then you come by me and I'll give you a balloon, okay? All right, can you get your praise sticks?
Sing, God is so good. So instead of, like our story said, instead of complaining, right, we should always remember how good our God is, right? That's what this song helps us remember. So will you guys sing with us this morning? Yes! Okay, let's sing. A seat. Don't forget to put your praise sticks back in the box, please.
Our offering today will go for Texas Vision. And as the ushers come forward, I would just like to share with you a little bit of research. There's a text in the Bible that says, God loves a cheerful giver. So I could talk an hour on that one text, but I won't do that. But what does it mean to be a cheerful giver? It means you're happy. The research tells us that I could give you $1,000 and it would only increase your happiness by 3%. And you might say, well, give me a chance. I can also tell you that when we come here and members give, whether it's here or online, it increases your happiness. If you come and you don't give and you're welcome, your happiness increases because of the people that give. That's the hard research. So when you give an offering today, whether it's tithe and offering, I want you to do it in light of eternity. The Texas vision is to support Evangelism Academy, Lake Whitney Ranch, and education. Give in light of eternity, because if we don't, we're giving in light of the present. I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward. Lord in heaven, we ask your blessing on this offering today. May you bless the gift and the giver in Jesus' name. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, church family. I invite you to kneel where you are as we come before the throne of grace. Father God, Lord in heaven, you are awesome. Lord, we are thankful for the blessing and the opportunity to be able to come before you here in your house of worship and praise you. We are thankful, Lord, during this season of gratitude for the tremendous blessings that you have given us, the big blessings, the small ones, the seen and the unseen, Lord. We come before you humbled. Lord, I want to pray for those that are in need, physically, spiritually. Lord, I pray for your comforter, the Holy Spirit, to dwell with them, to be with them, and for this community, this body, to be able to share your love with them, Lord. I pray for this church. I pray that each member, each visitor be lifted up, Lord, that their needs be met, and that your Holy Spirit fill their hearts and fill their homes. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings and for all you do for this community and for this church. We pray all this in your name. Amen. Amen.
I don't know about you, but I absolutely love this time of year. This time of year where we have thankfulness in our hearts and this attitude of gratitude that we have this time of year, I think God is calling us to have year-round, every day of our lives, right? To have an attitude of gratitude, to be thankful for all that God is doing. And you probably noticed in your bulletin today that the order of service looks a little bit different, because it is. This is our tradition here in Burleson, that the Sabbath after Thanksgiving is our testimony Sabbath. You know, Ellen White tells us that we should be testifying more and more, sharing our testimonies. And so we want to do that. We want to hear from each other how God has been leading, how God has been working. We can argue about theology and what the Bible says and all that stuff, but we cannot argue with the impact that God is making on the life of a person and his involvement in their life, right? Amen? So today we're going to hear from several people. We're going to hear from Keith Jenkins. We're going to hear a testimony from John and Sherilyn Taylor, from Carlos and Ruth Zorzine, from Gerald and Beverly Peterson, and from John and Kimber Turner. And we're just excited for all of you to be brave enough to stand up before your church family and share. And really, we don't want you to be nervous. We want you to just talk to us as your brothers and sisters, because that's what we are, church. Aren't we a family? We sure are. So join with me then as we read a scripture. Psalm 100, 1 through 5, it says, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Another amazing day to be grateful to Jesus for his sacrifice. So please stand with us and worship our Lord with our first song, "Shout to the Lord."
Thank you. Hello, happy Sabbath. Okay, cool. All right, I have a few questions. So first of all, my name's Keith. I just started reattending here to Burleson this year. So glad that I have. So I got a couple questions. So who this week has eaten too much food? Just a show of hands, right? Just so we can get on the level. So I'm with y'all there. What about who's done some Black Friday shopping? Who did any of that? Anybody? Yeah, a few people. All right, let's see some bad things. Who's ever scraped their knee? Scraped your knee, yeah. What about who's ever broken a bone? I see a lot of guys in here, right? Oh, a lot of women, hey. Broken bones, okay, awesome. I got one more question, okay? Who's ever, me and Will talked about this one time, who's ever been punched in the face? Yeah, you have, all right. All right, so a couple things with that. If you've never have, it's an experience, all right? But I will say this, if you know it's coming, there's this thing, like you can kind of prepare for it. You can kind of move your head a little to the left or right, backwards, so you can take someone to blow. Some of y'all know that I in my free time, I do practice the arts. And so when I'm in the ring, I see the guy throwing a punch or a kick. I'm able to move, and I can kind of take some away, and it doesn't hurt as bad. But what's called a sucker punch is the one that really gets you. You don't know it's coming. You're walking. You got a bully at school or wherever, and then bang, and you just don't get to prepare, and it's just all out, disorientating. So here recently, I got punched in the face. Spiritually, though, as a lot of y'all know, just about 4 weeks ago, my father passed. And I know through talking to others who have been able to be there while their parents were in the decline, they were able to go through that, and it kind of took some away from it, right? It's still a hurt, right? But they were able to be there and have that last moment and that beautiful time. Well, I wasn't able to get that. It was a sucker punch. I wasn't prepared. And so the one thing that my coach tells me, practice, continue to practice. So when those moments come, you'll know what to do. And I always thought, you know, that only translated in the ring, but I'm now seeing that the more that I have read this last year, like I've been reading the Bible a ton. Me and Pastor Kev talk about it a lot, but I've been reading the Bible a lot with my dad, and just doing so prepared me for this moment. Because a lot of times what will happen is if you get hit and you don't know how to take a punch, you hit and then you're done. You're just like, oh, I can't go no more, you know, help, you know, whatever. But if you've been practicing, well, you get hit and then what? It's like, okay, well, no, hold on. Shake it off. We keep going, right? Listening to your coach's voice. Because being in the ring, I'm going to tell you, It's crazy. It's hot. There's people yelling. There's people booing at you. There's a whole lot of distractions, right? And you get disoriented. And if that punch hit you and you weren't ready for it, now your eyes are watery and maybe your nose and you're just trying to see. You got a mouth guard. And like I said, you're sweating. It's hot. People are yelling. It's a whole lot going on. And that's how my life has been the last 5 weeks. It's like the burial, the this, the that, the house, his stuff, my sister, my mom, my all the family, all his friends, all my friends. It's just so much, my own stuff going on down here in Texas. Having to go back and forth between St. Louis is disorienting. But it's the cool thing is that this whole year I've had practice, what? Staying with God, reading, knowing where to go to get my strength when I'm just waves and waves of emotions and stuff, right? So that sucker punch, it did hurt, but guess what? I'm able to keep going because I have my Heavenly Father. So I just want to encourage you guys that no matter what comes in your life, man, pain is pain, right? Don't look at somebody and go, oh, they're going through that. Man, that's not as bad as what I'm going through. I don't have my rent money, or, oh, man, I don't have money for lights, or, you know, I just got fired. Don't look at it like that. Pain is pain, all right? But we all can go to the exact same coach, our Father in Heaven, to get us through those times, all right? That's all I have to say.
Amen. Thank you, Keith. Church, I invite you to read with me Psalm 22:22. I will declare your name to my people. In the assembly, I will praise you. I invite you to join us in praise this morning.
Good morning, church. Well, my story, a little backstory in case you may not know who I am. I'm John Taylor. I am a pastor's kid, so I kind of grew up in the church. And there for a while, I kind of drifted away. And when we moved to Burleson, it's been about, what, 5 years?
Six and a half.
Six. 6 years ago, I kind of reaffirmed my faith with the Lord. It was, I was kind of like the lost coin. In the church, I was present. But really wasn't involved. But this church has given me a home, given us a home. And I'm so thankful and blessed for just for everything. I get emotional, I'm sorry. Thank you, Lord, for all the many blessings you have given us, O Lord. I can't even begin to thank you enough. Church family, thank you so much for giving us a home, welcoming us here. We are so blessed, our family. Thank you so much.
Sherilyn and John, and we are blessed that you guys are a part of our church family. You guys got here and immediately started working. You know, like, yeah, well, praise the Lord. And so your gratitude and appreciation for being welcomed here, we feel gratitude and appreciation for you guys being you guys. And we're so glad that you're here.
Thank you.
Amen. We're going to have another scripture reading. All right. Well, I'm going to read it. Do you want to read a scripture with me?
I would.
All right. Let's do it. Psalm 9, 1 and 2. I will give thanks to you, Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing the praises of your name, O Most High. That is our God, and we give thanks.
Church, for this one, we invite you to stand with us because this Sabbath morning, we are here to worship our God. So I invite you to please sing with us, sing with your heart, because we are here to worship our Lord today.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. Sing praise.
Good morning, church family. I'm going to tell a small story. Actually, I haven't told in almost 25 years. About 31 years ago in Brazil, I was flying a helicopter on a very remote area of Brazil. And we had what we call a catastrophic failure. And basically, the aircraft started to fall apart midair. And we started an emergency descent in an attempt to land, but the aircraft, the control links were disconnected, so there was no more control on the aircraft. And we continued flying towards the ground, and we hit the ground approximately 200 statute miles on a 75 degree angle. The aircraft was completely destroyed. The fuel cells burst, and we had a cargo. Actually, we had a fuel cargo inside the aircraft, and everything kind of burst. The fuel gushed out everywhere. And believe it or not, there was no ignition, there was no fire, there was no explosion like we usually see. And actually, it should happen, because usually when you have an aircraft explosion, because a hot part of the aircraft hits the fuel, and which happened there. But it didn't happen in my case. And the impact was so huge, you know, my seat belt broke and I was thrown out of the aircraft. And that was God's providence, actually, because as soon as I was thrown out of my seat, the aircraft transmission, which is a piece that weighs about 400 pounds, went crashing down and hit my seat, and I wasn't there, miraculously. So at the time, the locals came, tried to help me out. They were initially, they were afraid to get, you know, to me, because they could smell the fuel. There was fuel everywhere. And they were afraid, and I told them they could approach. It was safe to approach. So they came and they started dragging me. They put me on this bed, on this truck, and they drove me to a hospital, which was a university hospital. It was about 80 miles out, so it took like an hour and a half to get there. And when I got there, it was quite a sensation. By this time, you know, the media already heard about it. And they took me to the OR, and initially they were under the impression only my feet were broken. Actually, I had open fractures, and all the bones went into the dirt, and it was a horrible scene. So initially, their intention was to have a surgery on my feet only. They didn't realize I had something on my bowels. And then I started complaining, hey, I have some pain in my abdomen. So that's when they decided to run some tests, and they realized I have internal bleeding. So when that happened, actually, right before a surgery, I told them to notify my family. And the interesting part is, we didn't have a phone in our house. And at that moment, I gave them a phone number and a name for this man to notify my family. But the thing is, I don't know this person, never heard of this person, and I could never memorize a phone number. So somehow that happened. And I was on coma for a few days.
Oh, it was a long journey for us. Carlos went through 29 surgeries, and when he was still recovering, I was found with cancer, and it was actually in a very advanced stage.
So her cancer was very aggressive and very advanced, and her chance of survival was actually very slim, according to the doctors. And at this time, we were completely broke. There was no money. I mean, the company, I was working for this company. It was supposed to be a good company, but they were actually not paying for insurance they were supposed to. They're taking the money out of my paycheck, but the insurance wasn't there when we needed. So we were broke, and I was still bedridden when they discovered her cancer. And we were in this real tight spot, you know. And we didn't know what to do.
You know, on top of that, one day I was in the afternoon, I just found, I received a phone call, and Carlos, he had been kidnapped. So it was from day to night, I had to raise like $25,000. And we didn't have any money, we didn't have anything. And it was quite a struggle to raise that money. But you know, God is good. He helped me. We had some good friends where we lived, and I got the money, and...
Yeah, they were trying to stop the lawsuit that was going on because of the insurance scam they were running. But she went through the natural treatment. Actually, we had on one of our church clinic in Brazil, and believe it or not, 6 months later, she was completely free of that cancer.
Yeah. After, and then we decided to come to United States, and well, all that we had was like two suitcases with clothes, and Paula was 7 years old. She got to bring a backpack with like a Barbie and toys. And you know, God just started opening doors for us.
Yeah, you see, we always talk about this, you know, how we were raised, you know, as Seventh-day Adventist, and we kind of tend to take everything for granted. We're sometimes not grateful enough for what we have, the small details in life. And we've been through this crucible. It was really, we had several real tough situations we've been through. But we can tell every time how God was there to help us out. There was never a situation where there was not, you know, door open or someone to help us out. And now we have a wonderful, life in America. We have a wonderful family. Wonderful kids. We love our family. We're proud of them. And I have a good job. And
we know God was, you know, God was seeing just the big picture, and He knew that we needed to go through all of these trials, so we could be closer to Him today. And I thank Him so much. And I love Him more than anything today.
An amazing testimony. Thank you, Carlos and Ruth. Church, I invite you to read with me Psalm 107, verses 8 and 9. Let them give thanks to the Lord for His unfailing love and His wonderful deeds for mankind. For He satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Amen.
I made it up the stairs. I'm surprised.
That's because I held on to him.
On January 4, 2014, my wife of 15 years passed away. Sabbath morning, 7 o'clock. I'll never forget that. She had been on hospice in our living room. And I was taking care, I had to do all the cooking and everything. When she passed away, I made up my mind I was not going to get married again. But the next day, the first day into the Sabbath, which is Sunday to most people, I got out of my bed and I knelt down and I said, Lord, in Genesis 2:18, You said it's not good for man to be alone. But I'm alone, Sylvia's gone. So could you kindly fix it? Well, time went on. I got into a relationship that wasn't going anywhere, so I ended it. And I went back to the Lord, and I said, Lord, you know me in relationships. I'm lousy. I had two failed marriages. And I said, if I find someone I'm interested in, I'm going to say to that person, I'm looking for someone to study the Bible with and to pray with. And if that person says, so am I know I'm on the right track. So, her pastor, Tom Petzer, called me up, said, Gerald, can you come up and preach for me? I said, yes, I can.
To the McKinney, to the Dennis and Sherman Church, where I lived.
So I drove from Cleburne to Sherman Denison, and I had the sermon. And after the sermon, while I was preaching, where were you sitting?
Well, on the second row from the very front where we sit today.
And she said on the main aisle. But as I was preaching, I had eye contact with everybody in the congregation. But her, I never saw her, right under my nose. So the sermon was over. I go back to the back to greet the people. She was the first one out the door. What did you say?
I really appreciated your sermon.
I never heard her. I never saw her. So we went to fellowship lunch. And I was sitting on the same string and table that she was sitting on. She was on the end, and I was in the middle of the middle table. Never saw her. So I said goodbye to the people that I was conversing with and walked out the back door to get in my truck and come home. And what did I see?
A few ladies talking together, and I was one of them.
And what did you say?
You were walking past, and I said, I really appreciated your sermon.
At the sound of this voice, I stopped dead in my tracks. I turned around and I said, could this beautiful creature be speaking to me? The Lord planned it that way, because we talked for over an hour in the hot April sun. And I was so struck, thunderstruck, you might call it, that I gave her my phone number and never got hers. But she said she was going to be in Alvarado the next to women's ministry meeting. And so after the meeting was over, they were ready for the entertainment, we'll call it. And she calls me up. And so I jump in my little truck, and I think I went faster than I should have. But anyway, I made it over to the church. And we sat down at this long table. There was only two chairs there. So she sat on my right hand, and we were sitting together and talking. And I noticed she had her left hand on her left knee. So I gathered up courage, and I put my hand on top of hers, thought maybe she would pull it away. But what did you do?
Oh, no. I put my right hand on top of his.
Wow. I knew at that point and sometime in the future that I would be married to this lady. So after a trip to Kenya, Africa, where she taught the natives how to better take care, and I preached a month-long series of sermons, we got married. Pastors over in Africa wanted to marry us. I think it would have been fun to do that and then get remarried over here. But anyway, we came home. And we got married, what was the date?
The date.
September.
18.
And what year?
2016. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And we've been happy ever since. We've had our ups and downs, like everybody. But I will say this, the Lord knows what we need. And when we ask Him, He will give it to us.
Amen. Are these two adorable or what? So you had mentioned, and I don't know if I just missed it as I was listening to your story, but you had mentioned that you were asking the Lord that you wanted someone to study with, yes, and that they would say, so am I.
I missed that, yes. So in our conversation Sabbath afternoon, I said, I'm looking for someone to study with and to pray with. And what did you say?
So am I.
I knew then I was on the right track.
That gave you the courage to put your hand on her knee. Yeah. Amen. Well, I think we have learned here, young people, if you've heard this story, there is a formula for success in finding your spouse, and that is looking for someone that you can study and pray with, and they're looking for someone to study and pray with too. Amen.
It works for both sexes. God is not... He watches over all of us.
He sure does. Amen. What a story. What a testimony. Don't you love how God cares for us at all phases of life, when we're new out of the womb and, you know, when we're seasoned? It doesn't matter. We are God's children, and He cares for us at every turn, and our prayers are heard by Him no matter what. I love that about God. Would you read this scripture with me? 1 Chronicles 16:34. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, and His love endures forever. That is such a true statement today, church. His love does endure forever. I'd like to invite John and Kimber Turner, if you guys want to come forward and share with us what is on your heart this morning. And Ryan. Good.
Good morning, church family. Again, I'm John, this is Kimber. We started attending here February of this past year, and I wanted to tell you guys a little bit about our testimony and how God directed our path to here. Story starts out with... I worked at a company for 18 years. I was a partner and a production manager. And we had to close our doors after the 18 years due to the pandemic. It shut us down. Our major clients were schools and churches, and nobody was going to school and church. So pretty much we ran out of funds. Meanwhile, I'd been feeling impressed for some time to move out of the city so we could have a garden, raise some chickens, let our three boys just run and play outside without having to worry about traffic. Kimber's sister and family happened to move to Texas the year before. Her husband had taken a job. So as we were looking for land anyway, Kimber decided to expand her search to include the Fort Worth area.
Which he told me would never happen.
I laughed at her and told her it would never happen, that's for sure. I wasn't leaving the Phoenix area. By this time, we had picked October 1st, 2021, as the day we were going to stop production and close the doors for the company. I told the owner I would work another couple weeks cleaning things up and getting things ready for her to sell or move. I really didn't want to work in the same industry anymore. After being my own boss for 18 years, I was putting my faith in God to provide for me and the family. Like sisters do, Kimber and her sister talked about our situation. Her sister said that she had talked to her husband and there was a position open at his company that I may be interested in. Again, I kind of shut things down. I told her I'm not moving out of the area. That would never happen. Kimber proceeded to show me a house she had found in Joshua and told me there was a Seventh-day Adventist church and school only a few miles away. I still didn't think too much about it, but as time went on, I continued to pray and ask God for direction. My brother-in-law mentioned to Kimber several more times that he was still looking to fill that position. So at this point, I started feeling an impression that I should just apply for the position. I decided to talk to my dad about it. I didn't want to just move and leave my dad and my sister there in Phoenix. And so after talking with my dad, he was actually okay with the idea. He was game that, you know, he was willing to pick up and leave if I took a job somewhere else outside of the area. So, so Kimber, at that point, she brought back to my attention the house she had looked at. It was a 4-bedroom house with a 2-bedroom home on the same property, which we would need with my dad and my sister moving as well. We kind of became excited about the idea, and the idea of change and a new chapter in our lives. So I applied for the job. After several weeks, I'd still heard nothing, and we were beginning to kind of feel that maybe this wasn't the right move for us. It was about 2 weeks since I received a paycheck. I was still waiting on God for direction. I received a call one Friday afternoon from my brother-in-law saying that the company wanted to fly me out for a few days so I can take a look at the operation. By the following Tuesday, I was heading to Texas, and I talked with the company. I went home from that trip and talked with my dad and with Kimber, and after a few days of prayer, we decided that I would take the chance and
moving to Texas
and take the job. So I drove to Texas the following Sunday, and with the plan of working a few weeks just to see if I was a good fit for the company and the company was a good fit for me before I moved the entire family out. By this time, I drove home last Thanksgiving, and we just decided to go ahead and take the job. I felt comfortable enough. So now it was all up to God. We had 2 homes to pack and sell and to find a place to live. Kimber had put the house on the market and sold it within 3 days. The realtor we used bought my dad's house, so we didn't have to even sell that one. I drove home a week before Christmas, and we packed up everything, and we were on the road Christmas Eve. My father was still extremely weak. He had just been going through a really bad bout with COVID, and my sister and I were just, Kimber and I were just exhausted from packing up the 3 moving pods and getting things ready to leave the house. We drove the 1,100 miles, and arrived at our rental about midnight Christmas morning. It was a 2-bedroom, 1-bath Airbnb that I rented. We had 4 adults, 3 kids, 2 dogs, and a cat sharing this tiny home. God was teaching us patience and what it was like to live as a close family. The house that we did like declined our offer, so we started searching and searching. We felt that God was in control, and we still needed, and we were still thinking he wanted us in Joshua because of the school and the church. We continued looking around the area and finally expanded our search to within 30 miles of my company because we just weren't finding anything. We found another one up north of Fort Worth, and again, we weren't able to reach a deal. Kimber happened to talk to the principal at the boys' school in Glendale, Arizona, and he told her to check out the school in Burleson. He said he knew that he said he knew and had worked with Carrie, the principal, and that he would recommend that school over the school in Joshua. Now, that kind of did it for Kimber at this point, because she had a trusted referral that she had, and she wasn't willing to take any other thoughts at this point. By this time, we were almost at the end of January. We had less than 10 days before we had no place to go, because the Airbnb that I rented was already full. I mean, it was already booked ahead, so we had no place to move into. We looked at this particular house in Alvarado 3 times. But it was the 3rd time after looking at it that we knew that this is what God wanted for us. We made an offer on the property, and we're told that the land survey takes about 10 days. By God's divine plan, everything was completed within 7 days, and we were able to move in 2 days ahead of with time to spare from our Airbnb. Amen. So to sum it up, God's direction on our path, one, he gave us the openness to consider moving. He literally had to change my entire mindset because I was dead against moving. He sold our homes for more than we asked. He gave Kimber the strength to pack 2 houses as well as solely take care of 3 kids, a 6th sister-in-law, and a father-in-law with COVID during this period of time. We were blessed with the help of some family and good friends. He provided me a job. He provided us with home within 10 miles of school in town. He provided us a church family. He provided us an Adventist school. And because of God providing all this, we were in the right place at the right time, and having an Adventist hospital to provide care for my dad, who in May was diagnosed with severe colon cancer. So most of our journey was not as we planned, or as we would have done it or wanted it, but we truly believe that God has us here for a reason.
Thank you, John. Thank you, Kimber, so much. You guys have been a blessing to this church, you and the boys, to the school. So you guys are a treat. Thank you so much for that testimony. Church, I invite you once more to read with me Psalms 95, verse 2 through 3. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. Amen.
Majesty, let
How great is our God today? You know, I love a testimony Sabbath. Obviously, it's a time where we're reminded, if we have forgotten, who our great God is and how he leads in the lives of his people. It's a time where our faith is renewed. It's a time where we remember maybe things that we have since displaced. But not only that, it's also a time for us to see each other, right? To hear from five different families the things that they've gone through and how God has led draws us together as a church family. I would encourage and invite each of you, if you have some time, some curiosity, get to know these five individuals that shared their stories. Ask questions. There is so much more to these moments, these snippets, than all the story holds. And I know that we each have a story, don't we? Those that didn't share, how God is leading and how God is using. Maybe we can take today as a time to write our story down and be prepared to share that with others. I just love today. I love how we heard that God is our rock and that on him we have a sure foundation. And I love hearing how God brings us home. No matter where we go in life, he draws us home and he puts us with a people. And I love hearing how God takes us through the impossible things of life. And he holds us and walks us through those valleys to a better place. And I love hearing how whatever our desire is, he hears it and he provides and gives us the good things that he has in store for us. And of course, how he answers all of our needs. He makes a way where there is no way. Friends, that is our God. Let us be thankful. Let us celebrate. And let us leave here ready to share our story with those around us. Would you stand with me as we close this morning in prayer? Heavenly Father, it is to you and you alone we praise, that we glory. We thank you in each life here today, those that we heard and those that we haven't. You have been intricately involved. You've been guiding, leading, protecting, restoring, rebuilding, and we praise you today. Lord, the story that is our life, may it be not just written in our hearts, but may it be written on our tongue as we share it with those around us. Father, we leave here encouraged, we leave here emboldened, and we leave here wanting to share. So bless us as we bless others, and we give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's people said, amen and amen. Happy Thanksgiving. God bless you. Happy Sabbath. May today be a joy to your heart.